David, American exceptionalism is looking like less and less of reality as we actually just look at the numbers. You've written about this topic for so long. Of course, you know, it's here in front of us. And and to ignore the numbers is just kind of a perpetuation of insanity. What's happening with the inequality issue, and how does that inequality issue affect what we love to talk about where it comes to this concept of American exceptionalism?
Well, America is certainly making itself exceptional, but not perhaps in ways that make much sense. If you look at the level of inequality in this country, it's not like that of Canada or Japan or Australia or New Zealand or Western Europe. It's like Brazil, China, Mexico, Venezuela, Russia. And the gains that are piling up at the top are just stunning. From 2009, that was when the Great Recession officially ended, through 2012. The top 16,000 households, now remember, we live in a country with 160 million households. We're talking about the 1% of the 1%. The top 16,000 households captured one-third of all the increased income in America. And the top 1%, that starts at about $360,000 a year of income, $1,000 a day. They captured 95% of the increased income. And the bottom 90% of Americans, about 280 million of us, average income went down. And it's now down to the level, when you adjust for inflation, of 1966. I was in high school in 1966.
Let's talk about the history of this a little bit. We come out of World War II. And, you know, the interesting thing about World War II is it was a window of opportunity for America. That window of opportunity was you had industrial nations such as Germany and Italy. You had agricultural nations that were devastated over across the Atlantic. And it's almost like when they bombed the hell out of Dresden, when they leveled Dresden, it was, yes, we're doing this knowing that this is an opportunity for America to capitalize on our industrial complex, to grow when Europe is going to be behind, when Asia is going to be behind. So we had this window of opportunity, it seemed to me, David, and then all of a sudden we abused that window of opportunity. And if what I mean by that is in the abuse process, we created this incredible distinction, this incredible inequality that exists as far as economics in this country. What is your take on that notion?
Well, unquestionably, you know, Dresden, Tokyo, other places, we burned to a cinder and did probably more damage to civilians than we needed to. But I think that was in the cause of winning the war and trying to reduce the number of Allied troops who were killed in the process. But coming out of the war, we continued to have reasonable equality in this country. The change took place in really dates to about 1981 when Ronald Reagan took office. And the several key factors are very clear here. Number one, you can track the worsening fortunes of the vast majority of Americans to the decline in union membership. And in Divided, there's chapters about why unions are important, why unions are market economics, and why conservatives who say they're for market economics should favor unions. They just haven't carefully thought this through. But as unions were cut and cut and cut in this country, the wages went down not just of union members, but of all the people around them. After all, if you're an employer who has a union workforce, you're paying X in wages and benefits and work rules. Another employer may actually pay higher wages just because he doesn't want the work rules. Well, when 37% of private sector workers belong to unions, about 80% of workers benefited. So that's been one of the important things that's happened is the destruction.
Well, the union movement in America created a middle class. I mean, people listening to this program have heard that time and time again.
And Mike, remember that we required Japan in its constitution to have unions. General Douglas MacArthur, who we all know was a famous liberal firebrand, right?
Right.
He's the one who said, you will have unions because we want you to have a reasonable level of equality, because that will reduce the chance that you will become bellicose.
Okay, so along comes Reagan in 81. Reagan says, gee whiz, you have to trust the billionaires. And if you trust the billionaires, give them more money, give them more tax breaks, the billionaires are going to share all that new wealth with you, that it's going to trickle down. And even back then, you had Stockton, you know, was supporting that. Stockton, as you know, has come out and said, well, now, in retrospect, that was insanity. That was Ronald Reagan's own guy that helped engineer the trickle-down economics. He says it's insanity. He says it's wrong. And I think, more importantly, one thing, if you listen carefully what Stockton says, he says you have to, in order for capitalism to maintain itself, you have to have the infusion of money. But you don't. You put the infusion of money at the lower ports of that economy, at the low and at the middle. And then hopefully that moves up rather than putting it all at the top and letting it trickle down. What is your take on how, you know, on how we have taken capitalism out of kilter so badly with this inequality?
Well, what we're practicing is not capitalism in the classic meaning of the word. And trickle down, a phrase the Democrats invented to denigrate Reagan's terrible policies, it's not trickle down, it's Amazon up. We are massively redistributing income upward in this country through all sorts of government policies that I've exposed in my earlier books and you and I have talked about in the past, that in subtle ways take a little bit of money from you and hand it over to the super wealthy elite in this country. You know, if you could get a penny a day from everyone in America filtered to you by the government, you at the end of the year would have $1.1 billion. So you don't have to take a lot of money from people to make a handful of people very well off. And the way
we've done that are things such as subsidies, we've done tax breaks, we've done, yes, you can keep your money offshore. We've armed the very top 1% with all of this, these ways to implement this movement of money from the bottom all the way to their pockets, haven't we?
Absolutely. And things like, you know, 2,900 big companies get to tax their workers. That is, the state income taxes that their workers have withheld from their checks don't go to the government. The companies get to keep them. Hundreds of thousands of workers affected by this, particularly in New Jersey, which is the state that does this the most. But 20 states have that. We have industries that by regulation force you to pay a tax that doesn't exist in law that is then kept by the owners of these businesses. And these are all very complicated mechanisms, because inducing this incredible complexity into federal regulation and the tax code, which businesses rail about all the time, is in fact a major source of corporate profits in this country. So the results of that are that the vast majority of Americans don't have the income to buy the goods and services that are needed to make our economy prosper. And why doesn't that change? Well, because the biggest companies, the ones that own 80% of the business assets in America, it's just 2,800 companies own 80% of the business assets in America, they're global companies.
Yeah, and
You can't afford to buy their product, that's just fine. Somebody in Singapore or India will.